something you're excited about. And if you look, oh, I forgot to bring my outline up here. We have outlines for you guys. There's a lot of fill-in-the-blank stuff here. Hopefully keep you focused. Keep you on board with me. We're going to be going through this pretty quickly today. Okay, don't panic because there's so much notes in there. Don't panic. There's just a lot of information. We're going to be going through it really quickly today. If all goes well, we'll be out of here on time. We'll see how it goes. Last night was about 25 minutes long, so I normally add around 10 minutes, so it'll be close. We'll see how it goes. But this is going to be kind of a fun one. We're talking about this whole idea, someday my prince will come. Do you recognize that phrase from any movie you may have seen at some point in your life? Who's man enough to admit that they watched Snow White? Anybody here? All right, there we go. Yes, thank you. We have some hands in the back. Thanks, Natalie. She's awesome. All right. Yeah, someday my prince will come. I'm not going to sing it for you. I want people to still be around. But you know what? That whole idea of someday my prince will come, right? For Snow White, that had a whole different meaning than it does for us. Last week, we talked about the rapture, this whole idea of Christ coming for the church. But we noted last week that that isn't when he comes to set up his kingdom. There is coming a time when he's going to come and set up his kingdom following the rapture. And so we're going to talk today about the events following the rapture of the church. We're going to basically go through the Revelation in 1 week, in one Sunday morning service. We're going to blow through the whole book of Revelation. So obviously this is a very bird's eye view, okay? But this is part of the doctrines of the church. This is the doctrines of the faith. This is the last sermon in this series. 15 weeks we've gone through this whole thing. I hope you've enjoyed it. I've enjoyed preaching on it. But this is something we need to know about. What's going to happen in the last days? The idea is that the Bible gives us clear teaching about the future. This teaching allows us to know with certainty what is going to happen in the last days. Before we get started, let's open with a word of prayer. God, we're coming to you today, and Lord, we want to learn something. And I pray you help us as we study your word. Lord, maybe there's something we can apply to our lives this week from the lessons you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. A lot of what we're going to do today is kind of it's a synopsis. So there'll be some passages we're going to be looking at, but primarily there's going to be sometimes I'm just saying, okay, this chunk of scripture talks about this event. So we won't be reading specific scriptures for a lot of this, but I got the references for you to look up on your own and read and kind of see where we're going along with this. This is, of course, the doctrine of eschatology, which is the theology of last things. All right, that's where the book of Revelation falls under. It's eschatology, it's prophecy, it's future events. It's the telling of the last thing. What's going to happen in the last days? The book of Revelation is the last book written by the Gospel of John, or by John himself. This is the last book written in our New Testament. Okay, it's written around AD 90. John was in Patmos. He was in exile on the island of Patmos when he had these visions from God. And so he recorded those visions for us. And that's what we're getting all this information from, primarily. You know, Matthew 24, 21, Jesus says this. He says, there will be a great tribulation, such as not been from the beginning of the world until now, no, and never will be. The book of Revelation describes this great tribulation. The tribulation that Christ talks about, saying, such as not been from the beginning of the world until now, and no, will never be again. All right? This is a horrific time where God pours out his wrath on the earth. There's a couple different judgments that God has. We have to understand, when you read the scripture, you talk about the wrath of God. Sometimes the wrath of God is poured out in a physical punishment. And sometimes the wrath of God is poured out in a spiritual punishment. So understanding which one that is can be a little hard sometimes. But we have to remember in scripture, there's different kinds of wrath we can suffer. Sometimes physically, sometimes spiritually. The book of Revelation primarily talks about a physical punishment upon this earth and the unbelievers who are alive at that time. In the end, the last couple chapters, it goes into the eternal spiritual punishment. But for the most part, all of Revelation is talking about the wrath of God poured out on this earth for the years that we have turned our back on him and rejected Christ as Savior. All right, so we're going to kind of do this little synopsis here. We have the church age right here. The rapture of the church happens here, okay? Sometime after the rapture, there is the start of the tribulation with the signing of the peace treaty of the nation of Israel. We don't know when that will happen. We don't know how long of an interval. Will this be from the rapture to the signing of the peace treaty? Will that be 5 years, 5 days, 5 months? We don't know. But we know that sometime in there, there's going to be a signing of the peace treaty. When that happens, that marks the beginning of the tribulation. The rise of the Antichrist happens in the middle of that, and all that we're going to be talking about today is going on in the current, ends with the second coming of Christ, the second advent of Christ. That's where it ends. So that's kind of a rough shot, a big picture of the book of Revelation, if you will, okay? So hopefully this kind of helps you make sense and picture what's happening. Last week we talked about the rapture. This week we're talking about the events following the rapture, okay? Including the tribulation, the rise of the Antichrist, the battle of Armageddon, the second coming of Christ, and then the millennial kingdom. All right? So let's dive right into this. Who are the main characters of Revelation? The book of Revelation. Well, you got Christ listed in Revelation 1, Revelation 19, chapters 1, chapter 19. Christ is a main character. The church, Revelation 2 through 3. Now it's interesting, more evidence for the truth of the rapture, that nowhere after chapter 3 is the church mentioned in the book of Revelation. It's not mentioned at all. Just in those first few chapters is the church mentioned. Nowhere in that time of judgment on this earth is the church mentioned. The martyred saints are mentioned, but not the church as a whole. All right? You have the two witnesses, Revelation 11, 3 through 13, the two witnesses that God protects, that God seals to share his message. You have the dragon, which is Satan, Revelation chapter 12, Revelation chapter 20. You see the dragon, Satan, as one of the main characters. You see the beast, who is the Antichrist. He's introduced in Revelation chapter 13. In 2 Thessalonians, you see him, and in Daniel as well, you'll see reference to the Antichrist. All right, so there's a lot of different passages of Scripture that talk about that. Primarily in Revelation, you're going to see him in chapter 13, 1 through 6. We have the false prophet, who is basically an assistant to the Antichrist, so to speak. He's found in Revelation chapter 13. Okay? And again, these are listed in Revelation chapter 21, the end of chapter 20, their punishment then is mentioned as well. You can see their punishment from the beast, the false prophet, and Satan, the dragon. And finally, you have the harlot, who's Babylon. Okay? It's Revelation chapter 17 through 18. Babylon represents, really, the doctrine of the world, the faith of the world, the religion of the world. Babylon is the whole world philosophy. It's actually a city, but it's a representation of what the world believes at that point. And there's coming time at the end of the tribulation where God is going to wipe it all out. All right? And we find that in Revelation chapter 17 and 18. All right. The tribulation period begins with the signing of the peace treaty, the nation of Israel and the world. Essentially, there's a peace treaty that's signed. But John begins in Revelation chapter 6 with these visions that he sees. And if he actually begins the description in Revelation chapter 5, he describes the visions in Revelation chapter 6, where he sees an angel with the scrolls that has seven seals upon it. And as he goes down through, there are seven seals, and each of those seals are broken in order. And as they're broken, there are different judgments that are released upon this earth. We're going to go down through the seven seals, the seven trumpets, the seven bowls, all of which continually get worse as the tribulation period goes on and on and on, leading up to the end of Christ's second coming. All right? So the first seal that we're going to read about is the white horse. Seal number one is a white horse, which is essentially it's a Cold War. The very first part of the tribulation, that seven-year period, is going to be a Cold War. It's going to be peace, but it's going to be peace with everybody's fingers on the button. You know what I'm saying? We can understand what that means. There will be peace, but it's almost a forced peace, so to speak, and almost, well, if I do this, they're going to respond back. All right? We don't know how long this Cold War will continue. It's going to be the very first part. But it won't last for long. What's going to happen is that second seal is broken and we get open war then at that point. On the world, nations will battle against nations during the tribulation. And this is God's promise and God's going to be behind this happening. Second seal is a seal of Cold War. The third seal is a black horse, which is famine. All right, now that tends to happen when you have wars, right? Especially worldwide war. They're going to have famine in the land. One day's wage will buy one meal. Now, what are you going to be like as a husband trying to provide for your family if you're working one day and you can only buy one meal for your family? The despair that's in this world, inflation is through the roof, right? And so whatever savings you have, you're going to blow through it very, very quickly. Very quickly. Trying to provide for your family. So not only do you have this open war, you have the whole idea of trying to provide for your family in the middle of it. This is not going to be a fun time. And this is just the third seal. This is the third judgment of 21 judgments. I hope this is kind of sobering for us because this is what Revelation describes. All right, moving on. Pale horse was released, the fourth seal, which is death to one quarter of the population. God says he will kill one quarter of the population, of the human population that's left in the land at this point. One quarter will die with this seal. Moving on. Number five, he opens the seal, and the slain souls are praying for vengeance, saying, how long must we wait, God? How long must we wait? During this time of tribulation, they will be turning against those who are believers, because there will be many, 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 into the millions we estimate, who are going to turn to Christ in the middle of this. Imagine how terrifying this could be for somebody who has grown up in the church, who knows the doctrines of the church, and all of a sudden the rapture happens and they understand it for what it is. They are going to turn to Christ. Now, they will not be raptured up. It's going to be too late for them to be raptured, but they're going to enter the tribulation knowing, with their eyes wide open, knowing what's coming. And during the tribulation period, many of them will be martyred as well, and they're going to be crying out to God, how long must we wait for vengeance? How long must we wait? And sixth seal is the Lamb's wrath. God responds to their prayers, and what happens is that we have an earthquake. Darkness falls over the earth. Stars are literally falling from the sky. So you have meteor showers like you wouldn't believe. It's what John describes. Where do you hide from this, right? I mean, it's one of these things. This is just a sobering thing to picture, but this is the book of Revelation. This is what John saw in his visions. This is exactly what he saw. The seventh seal is open, and there's silence in heaven for 30 minutes, and it's introducing the trumpet judgments. Now, we don't know at what time the trumpet judgments happen in the tribulation. Are they halfway point? Do they begin? Are they prior to that, after that? We don't exactly know. There's much debate on that one. What I know is that it's going to happen. That's what I know. I know that it's going to happen. So whether it happens in the first half or happens in the second half, doesn't matter. God has promised that this will happen, the seven trumpets. Moving on. So the seven trumpets found in Revelation chapter 8, verses through chapter 11, 19. John describes them like this. The first one is hail and fire. One third of the earth and trees and all green grass burned up. It's in time of famine. For those of you who have livestock at this time, you think maybe we can survive my family. Well, now your livestock have nothing to eat. What's this going to be like for you guys trying to provide? I mean, this is just a horrific judgment. God turns out a third of the earth and trees and all green grass burned up with trumpet number one. Trumpet number two, there's a burning mountain that's thrown into the sea, and a third of the sea becomes blood. A third of the sea life is killed, and a third of the ships are destroyed. That's what John describes. These are the judgments that God has for us. One third of the sea is turned to blood, a third of the sea life is killed, and a third of the ships destroyed. Think of the navies that are out there. Think of all the ships that are out there, cargo ships transporting things back and forth. A third of them are gone. The world economy is going to be in just utter disarray at this moment. It's going to be terrific for them. Wormwood. The scripture Revelation talks about wormwood. Basically what it is, a third of the fresh waters are poison. They're made bitter. You can't drink them. A third of the fresh waters are made undrinkable through this judgment from God. Trumpet number four, the sun, moon, and stars, a third of the heavenly bodies are diminished. Now, what does this mean? You look in Matthew chapter 24, where Christ says, for the sake of the elect, the days were shortened. Okay, does that mean that the days actually become shorter by a third? Instead of 24 hours long, they become 16 hours long? I don't know the answer to that. Whether it's the power of the heavenly bodies are diminished, so you only see two-thirds of the light they have now, or literally the days are shortened by a third. We don't know. Matthew 24 seems to indicate that's quite possible the days are going to be physically shortened in length for the sake of the elect. Otherwise, no one would survive. That's what Christ is saying. No one would survive the tribulation, but for the sake of the elect, the days were shortened. Maybe that only means that he's only going to make the tribulation that many years long. You know, if it was over 7 years long, nobody would live through it. We don't exactly know. I tend to believe personally that the days will physically become shorter. That tends to be my understanding of this. That's where I am, but that's my opinion. Okay, you can write it down as such, just my opinion. But when you look at Matthew 24 in this passage here, it seems to indicate quite possibly that the days are literally made shorter for the sake of the elect so that people can survive this time of judgment. Trumpet number five, demonic locusts are released from the earth. They're given the power to torture but not kill for 5 months. And Revelation says people will seek death and death will flee them. People will want to die and be unable to. Now that's going to be a great time, isn't it? Can you imagine what that would be like? To actually be in so much pain that you want to die and you cannot. That's what God says. This is his judgment on the earth. They will want to die and can't because of the demonic locusts who, really it's only for the unbelievers, torture but not kill unbelievers for 5 months. This is what's going on. That's trumpet number five. Trumpet number six, demonic horsemen are released. One third of people are killed. Previously, you had a quarter of the population. Now you have another third of the remaining population is killed through this trumpet number six. Trumpet number seven is released, and that introduces the seven bowl judgments. Okay? Now, to kind of help track along to see where we are with this whole thing, there's approximately 7 billion people in the world today. If you estimate 1 billion Christians, which may be high, may be low, this is just a number that I found out there, there's possibly 1 billion Christians, that leaves 6 billion after the rapture. If you kill a quarter of those, that leaves 4.5 billion people. After that seal number four. After trumpet number six, that leaves 3 billion people. So you have over half the population gone in just a short number of years. Are you tracking with me, people? Do you see what's happening here? Do you see the tragedy of this? And that doesn't include those that are killed during the Cold War, those that literally starve to death, those that get sick and die. It doesn't include any of those victims. These are just the ones from the trumpets. It's quite possible this number could be a billion off. It could only be 2 billion left. We don't know. We do know the numbers, and we can do the math right now, just with those two seals, seal four and trumpets number six. I'm sorry, those two judgments. This is what we know. This should be very sobering for us. This is what Revelation teaches. This is what the Bible teaches. Look up the passages. I'm not making this stuff up. Look at the passages. It's there. All right, moving on. Revelation chapter 15 through 16. We run into the seven bowls. In Revelation chapter 11, 12, 13, and 14, there's a little segment in the middle of that. There's a little pause in the middle of that where John begins giving a little bit of history. He talks some about the two witnesses that God sends on this earth. All right? There are two witnesses that come. They're protected by God. They're able to share the gospel. Those two witnesses are killed. Finally, they're killed. The world comes against them. And when those two are killed, then God begins to release a judgment. The world laughs at the two witnesses who are killed. And that's when we begin entering that second half of the tribulation, which is more terrible than even the first half of the tribulation. Now, does that happen in the middle of the trumpets? At the end of the trumpets? Again, I can't say with certainty. But I do know that those are two individuals, the two witnesses. You'll find those in Revelation chapter 11. Revelation chapter 12 tells the story of Christ being born. It has a picture of Mary. Okay, and then Christ being born and Satan coming down as a great dragon, ready to kill the son, Mary. He's killing the son of Mary, which is Christ, okay? And he comes down with a third of the stars with him. That's referring to the fallen angels. Revelation chapter 12. And we see that when Christ was born, Herod came out with his decree to kill all the Hebrew children under the age of two. That was Satan's influence. God protected them, and they went down to Egypt. That's also described in Revelation chapter 12, where God protected them. They went down into Egypt, and you see that, where Joseph was told to escape to Egypt, and they did. But then Revelation 12 and 13 begins to introduce the false prophet, the beast, the Antichrist, and his assistant is who those two are. Revelation chapter 12 and 13 begins to describe those two. We move on to Revelation chapter 14, where we begin to introduce this next judgment that's coming, which is the seven bowls. Bowl number one is painful sores on all who worship the beast. Now you sit there and think, okay, painful sores, how bad can that be? Look back at the story of Job. In the story of Job, God says to Satan, hey, have you seen Job? He's the most righteous man in the world, right? And Satan's like, God, you put a hedge of protection around him. You let me do whatever I can to him, and he will curse you. So Satan took everything away from him, his kids, his servants, everything he had, took him away from him. And then he comes back and says, and God sees him again and says, well, you know, Job still hasn't cursed me. And Satan's like, yeah, that's because you protected Job himself. Let me at Job now. Let me touch him directly. And God says, okay, but don't kill him. And the worst thing that Satan can do to him are these horrific boils, right? Imagine Satan and all of his power that he has, and God says, do your worst, but don't kill him. And so the worst thing that Satan does is putting these boils, these horrific boils on Satan. Well, now it's God's turn. All the unbelievers left in this world are experiencing what I think are the same exact thing that Job went through. The same exact thing, these horrific boils on all who worship the beast. And I would imagine that God gets a little bit different response than Satan does, because there are going to be many who are going to curse, unlike Job, who are going to curse. There are going to be many who are going to do that because of the pain that they're going through. Now, the scriptures say that none of them seek after God. They don't, but they curse their lives, they curse everything else because of the pain they're going through. All right, Bowl number two, the sea turns to blood. All the sea life killed. Now the sea is 100% blood. You can't run ships on it. You can't get cargo ships across it. You can't do anything. Everything in the ocean is dead because of bowl number two. Bowl number three, all rivers and springs are turned to blood. People are drilling for fresh water like crazy, trying to find something to drink because all the rivers, all the streams, everything has been turned to blood. The ocean has been turned to blood. What's this going to do to your families? All right. Number four, the sun scorches people with fire. Literally, when you walk out in the sunlight, the sun is given power to scorch you. People are getting first, second, third degree burns from the power of the sun. You have to have shelter during this time. This is the judgment that God has released on them. Bowl number five, there's darkness over the kingdom of the beast. Now, I'm not sure how to describe that. The scriptures talk about how Babylon is going to emerge. It's going to be rebuilt, which interestingly enough, is happening right now. The city of Babylon is being rebuilt and has been going on. Saddam Hussein started this. It's been continuing. The city of Babylon is being continually rebuilt right now as we speak. But at some point, there's going to be darkness over the kingdom of the beast, much like it was back when Israel, when the nation of Israel was in slavery in Egypt. And Egypt, there was utter darkness over the land of Egypt, but not over the land of Goshen where the Israelites were. I think this is much the same way, where the people who are believers, those believers will have light, but the unbelievers will not because of the total darkness over the earth. All right, Euphrates River dries up. Euphrates itself dries up, and then we introduce the greatest earthquake ever. The greatest earthquake ever, and 100-pound hailstones to accompany that. Now that's crazy to think about, isn't it? In Omaha, a number of years ago, this was like 2 years ago, they had a hailstorm come through. One of my good friends, Dr. Lonnie Hofer, he lives up in Fort Calhoun, and he had hailstones of about 3 pounds. Okay, they were a little bit larger than a softball. They were huge hailstones. They were punching through his roof sheeting. Through shingles, through his roof sheeting, through his drywall, and landing in his house. Okay? And those only weighed about 3 pounds. What do you do with a 100-pound hailstone? Where do you hide? There's nowhere to go. There is nowhere to go. And this is the final bowl where the city of Babylon is completely destroyed. This great earthquake levels mountains, levels hills. It's a horrific earthquake. This is the final bowl, and this introduces then that final campaign, which is called Armageddon. Revelation chapter 16, verse 16. And I saw coming out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast, out of the mouth of the false prophet, three unclean spirits like frogs. For they are demonic spirits performing signs who go abroad to the kings of the whole world to assemble them for battle on the great day of God the Almighty. And they assemble them at the place that in Hebrew is called Armageddon. We're now set up for this final campaign. Armageddon was more than just one battle. It was a campaign, movements of armies, going one place to another place, some victories, some losses, and then complete reversal in the middle of it. This whole campaign is kind of hard to see here, but there's 8 stages that happen. There's a gathering of the armies of Antichrist right here. This is the nation of Israel. Okay, this whole thing is the nation of Israel. So we're up here, we have the Valley of Megiddo, Armageddon, the Valley of Megiddo up there, okay? Babylon, we're not sure where Babylon is. I'm going to use these arrows to illustrate it because we're not exactly sure where Babylon is located. We believe it's to the east, okay? So they assemble here. Babylon is destroyed. What happens? They all come down here and converge on Jerusalem. Jerusalem falls to the Antichrist armies. Jerusalem is destroyed. The walls are torn down. The Israelites, they have fled. Many of them are in protection down here around Petra. We believe that Petra is a place where God will supernaturally protect those who believe in Him. The few that are left in Israel when it falls are going to flee in front of the armies down here to Petra. And at this point, we see the reversal. At this point down here, Israel begins to be regenerated and Christ returns. He begins fighting for the nation of Israel, for His chosen people, forcing the army back up to the north, and then Christ Himself ascends upon the Mount of Olives. Now, what's that battle going to look like? Revelation chapter 14 describes that. So the angel swung his sickle across the earth and gathered the grape harvest of the earth and threw it in the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trodden outside the city, and blood flowed from the winepress as high as a horse's bridle for 1,600 stadia. That's approximately 180 miles. That's almost the whole length of the nation of Israel, is what God's describing here in this final battle against Satan's forces. Let's look at that and let's kind of describe this thing. There's a mathematical form you can do. The length of blood, 950,000 feet. The depth is 5 feet. Multiply that by the width of the Kedron Brook right now, which is 5 feet. Now imagine the earthquake is going to shake that up a little bit. So it's possible that could be 5, 10, 20 times as wide as it is right now with the flattening of everything that happens. But looking at today's numbers, that's what we got. You multiply that by 7.48. All right, converting cubic feet to gallons divided by 1.5, which is gallons in a human body. And how many people are killed in this battle? Right now, the minimum, how many people are killed in this battle, in one battle, is 118 million people. And if you figure the width of that brook, if you figure it multiplies out because of the flattening, that could be a billion people very easily, just in one battle. How many people are left on this earth at this point? My guess, best guess, is way under a billion people. Or how many have survived the tribulation? God's wrath. That'd be my educated guess. Revelation 19. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. And the beast was captured, and with it the false prophet who in his presence had done the signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped its image. These two were thrown alive in a lake of fire that burns with sulfur, and the rest were slain by the sword that came from the mouth of him who was sitting on the horse, and all the birds were gorged with their flesh. In the end, God wins. You know, I've said to you guys before, we don't know what's going to happen in between, but we know what's going to happen in the end. And this, my friends, is the end. This is what Revelation describes. So then we enter into the stage of the millennium. We have Christ who comes back. Right, this is Christ's second coming. This is the Battle of Armageddon right here. After the Battle of Armageddon, Daniel talks about a 75-day interval that happens. Okay? If you want to talk to me about this later, we will. We're just going to kind of breeze through this quickly. There's a 75-day interval, and then we have the beginning of the millennium, the thousand-year reign, where Christ sets up his kingdom physically here on earth. Christ becomes the king. I said my sermon title, Someday My Prince Will Come. That's really the wrong word, but it went with the song, Someday My King Will Come. And during that time, those believers who survive the tribulation will enter into the millennial kingdom with Christ. We will rule over them as saints. We will get to rule over them. We will not actually be in human form at that point. 1 Corinthians 15 describes this. We will all be changed, but there will be humans who will enter that, who are left alive. The curse of sin will be taken. In other words, they will get to live forever. They'll be alive during a whole 1,000 years. The population boon will be tremendous. Okay, imagine never dying, being able to have children for that many years. I'm not sure why you'd want to, but they're great kids, right? Okay, it's going to be a great time. Yeah, the millennial kingdom, the millennial temple that's set up, they'll be worshiping Christ, making sacrifices to Christ because of who he is as the king. At the end of that 1,000 years, Satan is released one last time. Satan is released for one last battle. There will be those in the middle of this 1,000 years who will reject Christ as their Savior, even though he's physically on the earth. They will reject him as their ruler. They will reject him as their king. Christ will come. He will bring them all to, Satan will come, I'm sorry. He will bring them all together for one final battle. And it's at that point that Christ will that Satan will permanently be thrown into the lake of fire. When we have what's called the Great White Throne of Judgment. During the tribulation, the Christians will be going through what's called the judgment seat of Christ, which is where we are judged for the works that we do here on earth, not for our salvation, but for our rewards. At the end of that tribulation, we enter that millennial kingdom. At the end of the millennial kingdom is a great white throne of judgment, which is for unbelievers. There are two judgments. The great white throne of judgment is for unbelievers. The judgment seat of Christ is for believers. Two different judgments. And this one here is if your name is not found written in the book of life, you're thrown forever into the lake of fire. And scripture says, Revelation 20, that both Hades, paradise, Hades and heaven, everything is thrown in the lake of fire. And what happens is that Christ creates a new Jerusalem for us. There is a new Jerusalem that is created, and we will live in that new Jerusalem forever with Christ as followers of him. If we're not, we will be living forever in the lake of fire, which is eternal torment. With the dragon, with the beast, with the false prophet. So, signs of the times. When's this going to happen? Well, I wish I could say, but I can't. Jesus himself said, even the Son of God does not know. All right? But there are signs that we can look at. The nation of Israel. Israel will be a nation. Will that happen in 1948? That's one of the things as a sign of the times. Israel becoming a nation. The rise of Russia. We see that happening again, don't we? Yes, it fell, but now the power of Russia is beginning to rise again. We see this happening. You have occultism. All these different people who want to believe in anything but the scriptures.
Are we there?
Absolutely. We see that over and over again. Right? We see that in the tolerance of people. I don't care what you believe as long as it's not what the Bible says. That's basically what people are saying today. And we see that rise. We see apostasy, where people are falling away from what the scriptures say. They're walking away from that. You have children who are walking away from what their parents believed in. Think about where the church was 50 years ago and what it's like now. Where was our culture 50 years ago to what it's like now? 50 years ago, 50s, 60s even, the church was a place that everybody went to. And now not so much. Not at all. They're falling away from what we know as truth. The apostasy. We have the increase in travel and knowledge. Daniel chapter 12 talks about that. How there will be an increase in travel and knowledge. Man, are we there? Absolutely we're there. Look at what the internet has done for us. Look at what the world travel that people can do. Unlike any other time before us, we see this increase. Scoffers are out there. Absolutely scoffers are out there. We see that. Again, with the whole tolerance thing. Moral breakdown. Boy, can you say we got a moral breakdown going on right now? Absolutely, we have a moral breakdown, a worldwide moral breakdown. Okay? We have the one world government that's happening. Oh, I'm sorry, I missed the capital and labor conflict. The one world government. All these things are happening. You say, well, we're not quite the one world government yet. You know, we're not, but the stage is being set. How many of you guys have been following the Bitcoin? Okay? You ever heard of the Bitcoin? The Bitcoin is digital currency. That's accepted anywhere in the world. It's literally a digital currency. It's not based on anything. It's not based on gold. It has no standard. It's just a digital currency. The value fluctuates greatly on this, but it's out there. It's being used. You can purchase items with this Bitcoin. Now, am I saying that's what's going to be used in the future? I don't know, but the stage is being set for a one world government with one currency. It's absolutely being set for that. And finally, a one world church. Revelation chapter 17 describes that. Now, it's my belief that that'll probably happen after the rapture, but the stage is being set for this one world church. All right, so what? What does this mean for us? Well, Revelation 22:17. The Spirit and the Bride say, come. Let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who desires take the water of life without price. If you're an unbeliever today, the Bible is very clear in this last chapter, the last book of the Bible, come. You desire, take the water of life without price. In other words, it's going to cost you nothing. The book of Revelation should put fear in our hearts. It absolutely should. And God says, look, if this is making you thirsty for a Savior, then come. The price has been paid. Are you willing to come? Are you willing to come and have Christ pay the price for you? For those of us who are believers, we know this. Revelation 22, three verses later in verse 20 says, he who testifies these things says, surely I am coming soon. And our response is, amen, come, Lord Jesus. Right? Amen. Are we ready? We know he's coming. We know he's coming. I'm going to close in prayer. But I want you to think, are you ready for the King to come? Are you ready? Because if you're not right now in your chair, you can just say, God, you know what? God, I'm not ready, but God, I want to be. And God, will you forgive me? Will you take the punishment for my sins so I can be ready? All you got to do is pray that right there where you are. I'm going to do this closing prayer. And if you want to pray that right where you are, then after the service, you come to me and say, Pastor, today I became a child of God. I want to know so that I can worship with you, so I can celebrate with you. How great that would be. How great that would be. God, we come to you today and we look at this warning that you sent us. And right now, I pray that there's some here that has not yet come, that today they would choose to do this. Today they would come. Today they would place their faith in you for the forgiveness of their sins so that they can avoid this punishment that you have promised. And Lord, for the rest of us, we say amen and we say, come, Lord Jesus. And we give you praise for the fact that you are Lord. And someday you're going to come and we're going to worship with you. We're going to reign with you. And God, what a day that will be. We praise you for this, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.